Hello everyone, I'm back with another chapter of class 12. It's called Recursion. Now, what are we going to be learning in this chapter? In this chapter, we'll be learning what is recursion, what are the types of recursion, what do you mean by infinite recursion, and what is the need of a base case. Okay, so now let me just tell you or introduce you to recursion. But before that, I want to ask you a few questions. Now, what is a function? Okay, for those of you who have not gone through the topic called functions or are not aware of functions, I would suggest that you watch those videos first before you come to recursion, because recursion uses the concepts of functions. Okay, so now what is a function? A function is nothing but a group of statements that do a particular task, right? Now, how do we call a function? How have we been calling a function? We have written the name of the function, and in round brackets, we specify the values given to that function, correct? From where have we called these functions? Okay, we have called functions from another function or from the main part of the program or the global scope. Okay, now the next question I want to put forward is, do you think we can call a function within the body of that same function? Previous question, we said, yes, a function can be called from another function. But now I'm asking you, can you call the function, a function named as A, from within function A itself? And the answer is yes. Okay. And that is what recursion is all about. So what is recursion? The mechanism or the technique or the process where a function calls itself directly or indirectly is called recursion. Then what is recursive function? Such functions which call itself are called recursive functions. Is that clear? Okay. Now, what are the types of recursion that you will see? The first one is going to be direct recursion. What does direct recursion mean? A particular function calls itself. Now look at the example given on the screen. I have defined a function named as func1. And in the body of the function, what am I doing? I am calling the function itself. So that is called direct recursion. Indirect recursion. What does indirect recursion mean? It means one function calls, or let's say the first function calls the second function, and the second function calls the first function. So mutually they call each other. So if here, if you see, I have defined two functions, func1 and func2. Now what is func1 doing? Calling func2. And what is func2 doing? Calling func1. So this is a kind of indirect recursion. Is that clear? Okay, now let's look at an example here. I've just given line numbers also, because we know in Spider IDE, as I keep writing my lines of the Python program, I get line numbers there. This is just for you to know, or to tell you how program execution begins with Python. So line numbers 1, 2, and 3 are defining a function named as func1. Line numbers 4, 5, and 6 are defining a function named as func2. Now, what is line number 7 doing then? Line number 7 is neither in function 1 or function 2. It's the main part of the program, and it's where the program execution begins. So I'm going to be executing line number 7 first. Line number 7 is a call to the first function. So I do lines 1, 2, and 3. When I come to line number 3, I see a call to the second function. So I do lines 4, 5, and 6. When I come to line 6, I see a call to the first function. So I go back and do 1, 2, and 3. And this is going to be your flow of execution. You started at 7, it went to 1, 2, 3. Then from 3, it went to 4, 5, 6. 6 was calling the function 1, so it went to 1, 2, 3. And this process will continue. So what kind of an output are you going to be seeing? You're going to be seeing hello, hi, hello, hi, hello, hi, repeatedly infinite times. This is called infinite recursion, because in this part of the program, you're not saying when to stop. This is going on and on and on. But generally, when we write a program, would we want it to go on and on and on? No. At some point of time, we want it to stop. So in these functions, we would have to write certain conditions where there is no more recursion. And those things are, or those statements are called the base case. Now, before I take you to base case, I've written here infinite recursion. Let me just tell you something. It's not actually going to be infinite. Some of the, you know, the IDEs will maximum do up to 1,000 and it'll stop. Because, you know, you will run out of memory if you just keep calling each other continuously. So it'll call each other 1,000 times and then it will stop. Spider IDE, I was just checking with it, and it can call each other 3,000 times and then it can stop. But you can make out in your IDE, the IDE that you are using, or the Python shell that you are using, how many times does it, you know, continue infinite recursion. There is a function named as get recursion limit. Okay. This function will tell you, you know, how many times, you know, it allows this concept of infinite recursion. And there is something called set recursion limit, which, you know, you can tell the interpreter that this is the limit. Don't, if ever there is infinite recursion, don't do it 1,000 times, do it only 50 times or 70 times or 100 times, depending upon what value you set. Okay. Though this is not a part of our syllabus, I'm just telling you this. And this is in a module. Both these functions are in a module named as sys, S-Y-S, which means if you ever have to execute these functions, you have to import sys. Okay. So now let me just take you to base case. So what is a base case? I said certain conditions in my function that sees to it that there is no more recursion and the function will stop execution. Is that clear? So when you are having a recursive function, you write it in such a way that every time you call the function, it's getting closer to the solution of the problem. And base case is a location or a case where the problem will be solved without further recursion. And it stops us from going into an infinite recursion. Okay. Now your program could have infinite recursion. Again, I repeat, I'm calling it infinite because it's many times. And only it stops because of the control of the IDE. Okay. But there is no infinite because it's built in such a way. Otherwise, I would use up all the memory that I have. It's built in such a way that it goes up to some limit. And when it realizes it's still not going to stop, it stops execution. Okay. In most of the cases, it's 1,000 times. It could be more in some, Python shell. Okay. Now, you could have, infinite recursion in two cases. Either you have not written the base case, like I showed you in the previous example, or you have written a base case which is not logically right, so that base case is never met. So in that scenario, the recursion will keep continuing. Is that clear? Now this is the theory of recursion. Just to make you understand the concept of recursion, I'm just doing a sample program here. It's to find the factorial of a number. We've all learned how to find the factorial of a number, correct? So what is 5 factorial? 5 is nothing but 5 into 4 into 3 into 2 into 1. So mathematically, 5 factorial is written as 5 with an exclamation sign. Okay, so suppose I was writing a function named factorial. So what could I say? Can't I say 5 factorial is nothing but 5 into factorial of 4? Look at the statement I have given you on top there. Isn't this going to give me 4 factorial? And what is 4 factorial going to be? 4 factorial is going to be nothing but 4 into factorial of 3. And what is 3 factorial going to be? 3 into factorial of 2. What is 2 factorial going to be? 2 into factorial of 1. And what is factorial of 1 going to be? Nothing but 1. So this is my base case. When the value of n becomes 1, see, there is no more recursion. I'm just returning the value 1. In all the other cases, when it was 4, when it was 3, when it was 5, when it was 2, you are having a recursive case. Is that clear? So which means identify the base case and the recursive case. So in this example, the base case says that when n is 1, your answer is 1. There is no more recursion. But if n is any other number, then how are you calculating the factorial? It's that value of n multiplied by the factorial of n minus 1. So factorial 5 was nothing but 5 into factorial of n minus 1, which is nothing but four. Is that clear? Okay, so now let me just, this is just the working of it. Let's see the program. So first of all, let me just clear my annotations from my previous screen. Okay, so I have written a function named factorial. It takes a parameter n. If n is 1, it will just give you answer as 1. But if n is not 1, then what is it doing? It is going to a recursive case, which says 5 is nothing but 5 into, call the factorial once again, but passing the value 4. Now, when 4 reaches there, it calls, it will say return 4 into, so the previous 5 we have. So we have 5 into 4 into factorial of 3. Finally, when factorial of 1 returns 1, it's going to be multiplying 5 into 4 into 3 into 2 into 1. I think it's 120. And it's going to be returning that 120 into this variable called fact, because the function was called from here. And I am going to display it. Is that clear? So did you understand what is recursion and how do you identify the base case and the recursive case? Now, another interesting thing people would ask me is, didn't we do this question using iteration or loops? Yes, we did. We could do programs using loops or with recursion. Then is there some advantage of using recursion? Yes. You know, when your loops look complicated, you will see in some of the examples, when the loops look complicated, with recursion, it looks quite simple. Okay, so it is very simple, compact to make use of recursion when the loops look complicated. But is there any disadvantage? Yes. The memory recursive functions use and the time it takes is much more than iteration, because you have to keep calling the function. Whenever you keep calling the function, there is some requirement of memory that is used in the background. And obviously, if every time I'm calling a function, leave the function, go to that function, time is taken in that process also. That's called function overheads. So memory and time definitely is going to be more in terms of recursive functions. But with a concept of advantage, it is going to be compact and, you know, a little more elegant and not so complicated. When looping could have complicated lines, this would look quite simple. Is that clear? So I hope the concept of recursion is clear. In the next video, you could probably see some more examples. Okay, bye. Thank you.